Hello guys, welcome you back for the another software engineering session on testing and implementation. Today we are going to see about software implementation techniques. Yes, in software engineering we already seen that we have five different phases. In that phases we have seen up to design. After design we are moving into coding phase. So coding is called as implementation model. In our design phase itself, we have detailedly designed our entire software and implement in the coding phase. The goal of coding is to implement the design in best possible manner. And the job of a programmer, the programmer is to reduce the testing and maintenance phase of a software. It has to be simplified. So if you create a code 100% efficient, then we can reduce the work of testing engineer. What is the objective of coding? Programs developed in coding should be readable, understandable. It should execute effectively, and the program should utilize less amount of memory, and the program should not be lengthy. So your program should be very optimized and effective one. So what are the better ways to do our coding? So we have some coding practices that has to be followed as a global common thing. So what is the controls construct? So we have to create our control statements. So whatever the control statements we are using in our program, that should have only single entry and exit. It means in your program, if you use if statement, if else statement, nested if statement, for loop, while loop, any type of control statements, that should have only one entry and one exit. And we have to avoid the usage of go to statement. So it will create unnecessary complexity in the compilation of the program. So we should avoid it. Information hiding. So hide the implementation details. So we should hide the implementation details. So just like in abstraction, we are showing only the necessary features. So here in reverse, we are hiding the information, implementation details. And also for nesting, deep nesting can be avoided. So nesting can be like nested if statement or nested for loop, nested while loop. So that should be avoided. Only deep nesting has to be avoided. One or two nested cases can be allowed. So user defined data types. So most of the time, we have to use the user defined data types. That should be avoided. So you should go for a standard data types. And module size. When it comes to module size, your function should be cohesive. And if you have a large functionalities, then it will not support for the cohesive. So we should avoid the larger functionalities, and we should have module interfaces, and we should avoid changing code randomly. So it will create a side effect. We should not change our code randomly. And robustness, it means your program should not crash. Whenever you get an error, you should come back from the error condition. And always we have to give a default statement in a switch case. And empty catch block should be avoided. For each and every try block, we should have a catch block to catch the exceptions. That has to be avoided. Empty if and while statements should be avoided. It should be checked well and before. If it is an empty if statement, you should have a condition in the if statement, and while statement also you should have a condition. Without any condition, your if statement and while statement should be avoided. And check for return statement. So your return statement should be present in all the functions. It should have a return statement in all the functions. Whenever you call a function, your function should return some value. If you don't have any value, you should return zero. That you know well. And return from finally block. So finally block is the last block of your exception handling. If you face any exception in your program, your finally block will be, your try block will catch the exception. It will throw to the catch block. Catch block will handle the exception. After handling the exception, it will move on to the finally block. Any statements you want to mention in the finally block, mention it, and you should return back from the finally block. Trusted data sources. Whenever you want to connect it with the database, you should connect with a trusted data source. Exception handling is do it properly. It means if you want to handle exceptions, you should go with the proper methods with try block, catch block, and finally block. And we have a standard coding like ISO organization or IEEE organization. They are suggesting some standardization on writing your codes in any languages. For example, if you are using C language, that should be ANSI standard. So any good software development approach suggests to have some well-defined standard or rule for coding. These rules are called as coding standards. So we have some standard codings. It is common for all the languages. The first standard is nothing but naming conventions. Like if you want to create any variables in your program, for example, if you are using any area of circle calculation, for that we should have a radius. So radius of what? Radius of circle. So that we have to mention in the variable name itself. In a function name also, we have to mention it that this function is meant for calculating the area of circle. So it should be clear. And files. So get idea of files from its name. So you have to name your file accordingly. And commenting. Whenever you need, you should have a comment or layout. And your statements should strictly follow the rules given by the standardization like ANSI standard or ISO, IEEE, any standardization. So for implementation, we have seen two concepts, coding practices and coding standards. And third one is nothing but refactoring. So this technique is used to improve the code. We are not modifying the code. Whatever the code which is created already, that has to be kept as it is, and we have to improve the features of the code. It is done during coding itself. It also plays an important role in test driven development in code improvement steps. It means if you have created a code, that code will not meet the expected output, then it should be improved in some aspects. That thing has to be done by refactoring. So refactoring is nothing but a disciplined technique for restructuring an existing body of the code. We are not going to alter the entire code, just internal structure of the code is being changed and the external behavior has to be followed the same. So whatever the external behavior it possesses already, that has to be exist. We should not modify the external behavior, but only changing the internal coding part. So to get the expected output. So this is called as refactoring. In implementation techniques, we have another one technique called re-engineering. Whenever you want to apply the re-engineering principles, you should check whatever the implementations we have did already. And to improve that implementation, we are going for re-engineering. So it's nothing but it starts with business processes. So our system, we already created our system. That system, we have to analyze the business processes of the system, and from the re-engineering, we will get the output as an entire software application. So business process re-engineering. It has some six phases in business process re-engineering. The first phase is business definition. It's nothing but each and every business will have some goals. That business goals has to be identified, and that goal should be within the context of your software. That is, even though if you have a logical context, we should have some other additional context in business process re-engineering. We have four different contexts here. First one is cost reduction, next time reduction, next one is quality improvement, and personal development and empowerment. So these are the four key drivers we have to follow for the business process re-engineering. These key drivers have to be defined first. Then after that, we should go for process identification. The process that are critical to achieve the goals defined. So we have four goals, that is cost reduction, time reduction, quality improvement and personal development. For achieving that goals, what are all the processes we have to implement in the software? That has to be identified. Then process evaluation. The existing process is thoroughly analyzed and measured. So what are the processes we have identified? That identified process has have to be listed and evaluated whether it will create a success or not. Then the fourth phase is process specification and design. So based on the information obtained during the first three phases, that is business definition, process identification and process evaluation. So that three phases will give you some information. So based on this information, use cases are prepared for each process that is to be redesigned. So use cases. So what are the use in design phase itself, we have identified the use cases for our product. Here again, we are redefining our use cases based on the contexts, the four contexts which we have identified. And next phase is nothing but prototyping. So after use casing, we are redesigned our business model. So a redesigned business process must be prototyped before it is fully integrated into the software. So the last step is refinement and reinstantiation. So it means, so whatever the prototypes we have created, that has to be fine-tuned. So it has to be tested and it has to be approved by some knowledge. So based on the feedback from the prototype, the business process is refined and then instantiated with the business system. Okay, so these are the cycle for business process re-engineering. Our first step is process definition. From that, we are going for process identification, then process evaluation, process specification and design. After that, we are creating a prototype. The prototype have been refined and instantiation. So this is a loop. So after this, we will get a feedback. So based on the feedback, then we are again identify our new process. So we have to follow some principles for business process re-engineering. So organize around outcomes, not tasks. So here we are concentrating only on the outcomes, not the internal task. Your outcome should be perfect. So for that, we have to do that task. So have those who use the output of the process perform the process. So whatever the output we are expected, that output has to be created from the process. And incorporate information processing work into the real work that produce the raw information. So we have to input all the informations what we are gathered from the business analyzation. And we have to treat geographically dispersed resources as though they were centralized. So your resources may be available in a centralized manner, or geographically it is distributed in different locations. So we have to create a software based on that. So link parallel activities instead of integrate the results. So we have to link the relevant activities in parallel and put the decision point where the work is performed and build control into the process. So whenever we have a decision, then there will be some control. So based on the decisions, we are going for any true part or false part. So that has to be performed here. Capture data once at its source. So we have to capture the data. So whenever the source is available, we have to be captured our. Okay. Based on the re-engineering principles, we should, based on the business process re-engineering, we should re-engineer our software. So the re-engineering process always starts with inventory analysis. So we have different phases in re-engineering process. The first phase is nothing but inventory analysis, then document restructuring, then reverse engineering, code restructuring, data restructuring and forward engineering. Finally, we have completed our re-engineering at the forward re-engineering. So we will see one by one. So first, inventory analysis. Inventory analysis is nothing but build a table that contains all applications. So inventory is nothing but collection of whatever the work we have did. So establish a list of criteria. So what are all the criteria we have to mention? Name of the application, year it was originally created, number of substantive changes made on it, total effort applied, and date of last changes you have made, effort applied to make the last change, and systems in which it resides, and application to which it is interfaces. So these are the criteria you should have in your inventory, in your table. So analyze and prioritize to select candidates for re-engineering. So this inventory will have all the applications whatever we have developed in our organizations. So from that application we have to fine-tune and identify, prioritize our application for re-engineering. Then after identifying the application, we have to document restructuring. So we have to restructure our document. So the weak document, so if you have any difficulties in your documentation, then it will create a problem in your system. So weak documentation is a trademark of many legacy systems. So legacy systems are olden day systems. They are having a drawback on only documentations. But so we have to change it. So we have to modify it. So we should have more options for creating the documentations. The options are, creating documentation is for too time consuming. So it means if the system works, we will live with what we have. So in some cases it is a correct approach. See, we have created a system, but we don't want to create a documentation. Your system is working fine, but creating document will consume more time. So some organization may feel about that. So don't want to create an documentation, just we are going with the coding itself, but it will create a problem in future. So documentation must be updated, but we have limited resources. So we have to update all the activities what we did in our software into the documentation. Then the third option is, the system is business critical and must be fully documented. Whenever you create a full documentation for your software, it can be reused anywhere at any time. Even in this case, an intelligent approach is to pare documentation to an essential minimum. So all the features, all the activities what you have did for this software has to be documented perfectly. Then the next process is reverse engineering. So the reverse engineering is nothing but going in backward direction. So we are tracking back from the source code. For example, if you have a source code that is a dirty source code. Dirty source code means you have a problem in your source code. So what we have to do, we have to restructure the code, clean the source code. So whatever the errors or any unwanted statements in your code, that has to be clean. It has to be redefined and extract the abstraction. So we have to get the pure source code from the dirty source code. So extracting abstraction is nothing but processing, interfacing and database. Then after that we have to refine. So we have to simplify, then we will have the final specification. From the dirty source code to, we will get the specification. So usually your software engineering approach will start from specification to end with source code. But here we are taking the reverse direction. So that's why we are calling it as reverse engineering. So dirty source code, you are taking a errored source code and restructure the source code and create a specification from the source code. This is called as reverse engineering. So what is that phases in that source reverse engineering or the code restructuring? After identifying your dirty codes, so we have to change that source code into a clean code. So source code is analyzed using the restructuring tools. So poorly designed code segments are redesigned, violations of structured programming concepts are noted, and the code is then restructured. So any violations in the standardizations and statements, that has to be clear, and poor design has to be modified, and your source code is analyzed. The resultant restructured code is reviewed and tested to ensure that no anomalies have been introduced. So anomalies means any threats. threads for your source code. So your restructured code should have a pure clear code, so it should not have any anomalies. Internal code documentation is also updated. So after you cleaned your code, so it has to be updated in your documentation. Then data restructuring. So we have cleaned the code, so we are analyzing the source code. So the source code will have a data input, so the data is also have to be cleaned. So unlike code restructuring, which occurs at the relatively low level of abstraction, data structuring is full-scale re-engineering activities. So we are considering all the data sources, we are analyzing all the data sources, and we are extracting all the data and analyzing all the data. And if you have any errors in your data, that has to be restructured. In most cases, the data restructuring begins with reverse engineering. That's why we are doing. So we are reverse engineering, we are starting from code, from code to we are moving on to data. So current data architecture is dissected and necessary data models are defined. So any unnecessary data has to be removed. So data objects and attributes are identified and existing data sources are reviewed for quality. So all the data structures and data sources have been reviewed. When data structure is weak, what will happen? So if your data structure, entire data structure is weak and it will have only flat files, if you don't have any relational approaches, then it will lead to a flat approach. So you will not have a dynamic programming. So while the data has to be re-engineered and we have to improve the data structure. Because data architecture has a strong influence on program architecture, that the algorithm that populated. So your algorithm of your core business logic depends upon the data which we are providing it. So if your algorithm is working good, but if you are not supporting with the data, then it will create only erroneous information. So changes to the data will invariably result in either architecture or code level changes. So either we are changing from code and also we are changing from the architectures. So that is data restructuring. And finally, we are moving into forward engineering. So forward engineering is nothing but it is just a cost effective measure. So the cost of the maintenance of one line source code may be 20 to 40 times the cost of initial development of the code. It means whatever the cost you are spending for developing a software, that cost have been reduced in the maintenance phase. So if you are not doing any maintenance activities, it will lead to high budget. So redesign of the software architecture. So redesign of the architecture using modern design concept can greatly facilitate the future maintenance. Because of prototype of the software already exists, development productivity should be much higher than the average. When you are developing a product in the same domain, we already have a prototype. Based on the prototype only, we are developing the new products. So we are reusing the prototype. So we are utilizing the architectures. The user now has experience with the software. So we already have a prototype. We are supplying prototype to the user. User have worked in the prototype. So based on that prototype only, implemented a new product. So user is experienced. So therefore, new requirements and the direction of changes can be ascertained with a greater ease. So user have the experience on the product. Then finally, we should use the case tools. So case tools is nothing but computer aided software engineering. I already told you that. So case tools, IBM Rational Rose is one of the major case tool which is used in software development. It will cover all the five phases, right from requirements gathering to testing. So all the tools are available in the IBM Rational Rose. So like that, case tools will support for automate our software engineering process. And a complete software configuration, documentation, program and data, it is a package. It will exist upon completion of preventive maintenance. It means if you have all these features, then we are preventing the maintenance activities. We are reducing the maintenance cost by developing a proper software. So this is called as forward engineering. Forward engineering is nothing but we are developing a software from in our usual phases, but we are concentrating on all the phases. In each and every phases, we are having a review system. We are having in requirement gathering itself, we are concentrating in the perspective of maintenance engineer. So we have to reduce the test cases. In that angle, we have to create a software. So that's all about implementation techniques.